So I was watching Law & Order SVU the other day, and this rerun came on that I've probably seen 100 times. It's the one where a teenager gets cured of a heroin addiction using a drug called ibogaine. Dr. Huang says it's a miracle cure, but drug companies won't make it because its patent has expired, so they can't make much profit. And another doctor says that it has a 91% success rate at curing addiction in like 24 hours. Something like that would be a game changer in the real world for fighting the opioid crisis. And while Law & Order is fiction, ibogaine is real, although somewhat controversial. And that got me thinking, there has to be a reason this magical sounding drug isn't widely available, and turns out there is. So let's talk about it. Ibogaine is a drug that comes from the roots of a plant called the iboga shrub. It's native to West and Central Africa and has long been used for medicine and spiritual practices through either chewing on the roots or consuming it in powdered form. At low doses, it's a stimulant. At higher doses, it can be hallucinogenic. Once colonizers found out about iboga in the 1800s, they started exporting it to Europe as a stimulant, mostly in France. But it wasn't until the 1960s that Western researchers started to notice ibogaine's anti-addiction properties, and they did it basically by accident. In 1962, a 19-year-old named Howard Lotsov decided to try ibogaine for the first time. He had been addicted to heroin, but when his ibogaine tripping was over, he found that he had no more cravings. And yeah, it might seem counterintuitive that something like opioid use disorder could be cured by a drug that is itself a hallucinogenic. Like, how do we know Howard's results weren't a fluke? Well, like any good researcher, he did a follow-up study. His first subjects were himself and five of his friends with opioid use disorder. When all was said and done, five of the six people said their cravings had basically vanished. In a way, it really does sound like a miracle cure. You only need one dose, and some research suggests it'd be a pretty small one. Some research has also found that ibogaine can work in under 24 hours to relieve symptoms of withdrawal in addition to cutting down the drug cravings. Further research has been able to replicate Lotsov's success. A 2018 study from New Zealand reported that of their 14 participants, 12 were able to quit or reduce their opioid use after treatment with ibogaine. And a Brazilian study looking at 75 people with substance use disorder found that ibogaine treatment led 61% of them to completely quit. While that's not quite the 91% that they said on TV, that's still pretty good. We are not sure how ibogaine works in the body, but we do have some ideas. Generally, it seems to interact with a bunch of different receptors, including opioid and nicotine receptors. Basically, it does a hard reset on the receptors that are involved with addiction. Ibogaine also seems to deactivate some of the serotonin transporter molecules in your brain, which might explain the feel-good effects of taking it. So it might be using the same mechanism that an SSRI does to treat anxiety or depression, with a sprinkle of hallucinogens on top. Researchers also think that ibogaine's impact on serotonin pathways might allow people to reprocess the traumas that may have led them to develop their substance use disorder, similar to how MDMA and other psychedelics are thought to work. In fact, this reprocessing might even be why ibogaine has been reported to be beneficial in treating people with PTSD. But it's not all sunshine and roses. And before we get into some of the downsides, here's a quick ad break.
We hear that you want merch, and we hear that you want to support Complexly. Did you know when you buy merch, you support us? It's true! So here's the deal. The SciShow store is having a huge summer sale right now, because even the most generous people love a deal. You can support your favorite free science content on the web and get an extremely cool pin that everyone will love, like our Wandering Womb pin, inspired by the follies of doctors of old. If pins aren't your thing, we've still got you covered. It's hot out here, so you should probably stay hydrated, and what better way is there to enjoy your favorite beverage than in the SciShow Space Donut mug? You can sip all day while marveling at the fact that our universe may be shaped like a pastry. Or if you prefer your drinks in a can, keep it ice cold in our SciShow can koozie. We've even got a few favorite items from our SciShow rock subscription that you can pick out, no membership required. Every rock and fossil has a story, so you can't go wrong. Selected merch is up to 45% off, so get it while it's hot. Be part of the nerdy things revolution. Head to complexly.store/sale now. The sale ends August 15th, so don't wait. Time and magnets are running out.
While ibogaine's ability to mess with a bunch of receptors all at once might make it good for treating a lot of conditions, that's a double-edged sword, because it can mess with stuff we really want to keep consistent, like your heart rate. Ibogaine can interrupt the potassium-gated ion channels in your heart, which is as bad as it sounds. One 2023 review noted that ibogaine can be associated with arrhythmias that have led to sudden death. Ibogaine inhibits a potassium channel that is necessary for resetting the electrical pulses of your heart, which can mess with your heart rate in a major way. As Ice-T would say, that's messed up. Concerns about these lethal side effects caused the National Institute on Drug Abuse to suspend any funding for research into ibogaine in the 1990s. In 1993, a patient participating in an ibogaine study died, and the research was halted with no one willing to fund it afterwards. But it was never conclusively determined that the patient died because of the ibogaine. So without further research, the true risks still remain uncertain. A review article looked at all 19 of the known ibogaine-related deaths from 1990 to 2008, excluding those from people in Central Africa who took the drug as part of their religious practice, to try to figure out if ibogaine was the direct cause. They found that 12 out of the 19 people had pre-existing conditions and comorbidities that could have explained the cause of death, not just ibogaine, which sounds like reasonable doubt, but since this isn't a courtroom, that's probably not good enough. The thing is, it's pretty hard to sort out which effects were due to the ibogaine itself and which were caused by interactions between ibogaine and other substances in a person's system. There's a lot more work to be done before we can properly assess the safety of ibogaine as a treatment for substance use disorder. Which brings us to another hurdle. Contrary to what Dr. Huang said, there's a lot more keeping ibogaine off the market than big pharma not being able to profit from it. In the United States, ibogaine is classified as a Schedule 1 drug, meaning that there are no approved medical uses for it, and it has a high potential for abuse. Legally, that puts it in the same class as ecstasy and LSD. Ibogaine got put there because of those cardiovascular side effects and the lack of safety data for humans, plus the potential for addiction. It has also been banned by the International Olympics Committee since 1989. I'm not sure why you'd want to hallucinate your way through an Olympics competition, but that's not my call. But not everywhere is so anti-ibogaine. It is available as a prescribed substance in some countries like New Zealand and Canada, and it's totally unregulated in other places like Mexico and the Netherlands. So naturally, now some people travel to countries where ibogaine is legal in order to try and reap some of those purported benefits, especially if they live somewhere where it's forbidden. In the meantime, one of the current standard treatments for opioid use disorder is methadone. It works more specifically on the opioid receptors in your brain and binds to the receptors at low enough doses to avoid producing that high feeling. While it's helpful for weaning off of opioids like morphine and fentanyl, it's very possible to get addicted to methadone itself, which is why there's so much interest in alternatives like ibogaine. We do have some effective treatments for substance use disorder, but it would be nice to have a safer, non-addictive option that can get rid of drug cravings and withdrawal symptoms for good. Whether that option is ibogaine or not still remains to be solved. But either way, there's the real science behind this TV storyline.